Hello, ladies and gentlefolk, and welcome to yet more Minecraft. In this one, we're going to be looking at the genius that is Tango Tech. And decked out one. As a Redstone fan myself, one of the ways of learning is to take apart other people's inventions and to see how they work and learn from them. And decked out one is an incredible piece of work, and it was done about just over 4 years ago, I think. And yeah, wow. In this particular episode, we're going to be looking at the card system, the card filtering system, and how it was put together, how it works, and a few things to do with that, and what I've learned from it. In the meantime, this was copied out from the bowels of the game. Sunken Ship Super Mario RPG. He's a bloody genius, that bloke. yeah, what can I say? It's... yeah, right. Yeah, this, as you can probably guess, is a decked out one, delidded. So I've been becoming familiar with the maze and some of the secrets that are within it. Yeah. Oh boy, there's some real serious work going on in here. One of the obvious secrets is if you actually get chased into the library area by one of the beasts, is to hop in here, push the button, and yeah, you're out. Or rather, you're not out, you're up into another secret area. So yeah, so you can do that. There's actually a button behind that lectern. So yeah, it's been a case of going through it, learning it, and how it's put together in order to stand a chance against the various bits and pieces that are in here. There's a few things that we've found. I was going through the logs to find that Etho's beast had died, fallen into lava, but yet there was Etho's beast was still alive. Huh? How did that work out? Turned out there was two of them. There's me enlisting Brian's help in searching endlessly for any command blocks or anything else that might mysteriously explain the how Etho's beast managed to come into life, only to find out that there were two of them. So yeah. What we think had happened is I died at this location and left a death chest, and one of the ravagers had hopped onto the chest, hopped over the line, and boiled. So what we've now got is, in the actual game, we've got blocks, invisible blocks, blocking whatever the heck they call them. Can you get them through here? Blocking. No, they're actually over here, over there, but hey-ho. They're invisible blocks, so we've put invisible blocks around the top of everything so they can't jump in. And there are three beasts in the maze, so that's going to make life interesting for future games. But, yeah. This is the mechanism for doing a few things, actually. The first thing we're going to take a look at is the chest, and when you finish the game, you've given the offer of three cards, three books, and when you take one, the rest go. And it's linked in with the soul flames. When you punch out a soul flame, a signal comes back to this area, comes in through this area. Extinguishing soul flames adds automatic clank. So the first thing that happens is a signal goes off to increase your clank, just as if you'd triggered a clank thing, I think. Or it maybe automatically increase it, I don't know. But yeah, the other thing that happens is that it comes up here. And it comes up here. And it comes up and triggers a dropper. So you've got a 1 in 3 chance of this dropper generating enough signal to trigger this dropper. This dropper then has a 1 in 3 chance of triggering this dropper, which has a 1 in 3 chance then of triggering this. And this is where you have loads of resistance and strength level 2 and level 3 books. So when the game starts, a signal comes up here, fires these three observers, which fires three books out of here, which is the level 1 section, and into these hoppers. So the books are loaded before it's begun, and they're randomized by the fact that it comes from the dropper. When the game ends, this is sent at a reasonable speed and it collects all the books. I'm just going to grab a couple of books here to show the mechanism, and and the books are deposited in each of these three. Now you'll see that everything is at the moment held off by the fact that all of these lights are on. So we put in the droppers our three books, and these lights, whoops-a-daisy, go off. So as you can see, comparators are saying there's something in the droppers, so all the lights are now turned off. What happens when you take one of them is that one of these torches will light. When it lights, all this lot will light, and each of the droppers will receive a pulse. The droppers are all facing down, and they're all facing down into barrels. So when you take one book out of one of them, all of them fire straight down into the barrels, hence the other books go. And then they're all gathered up by these hoppers into this pile of chests, which basically goes nowhere. It's then left for the administrator to come in and tidy things up and put the books back where they should be. Very interesting mechanic. Very interesting mechanic. I won't just see that in action. But if I take this book out, ba-dumf, bang, you heard the click, and they're all gone out of the others. And they've now gone down into the system. When the chest, when the minecart comes back, it automatically settles down. It lives on hoppers, so any books which are outstanding, which are still in the cart, are then also likewise go down to another separate section. So that's how it all happens. That's how those are loaded, how the level 1 cards go in, and also how extinguishing soul flames stands a chance of unleashing level 2 and level 3 books. As it increases clank, that's a hell of a way to go. Now the other thing that I've got to say at this point is that this game was altered, and as we know from the clank chance itself, the sign, which I'm presuming was put by Tango, said there was a 1 in 9 chance, but the actual contents of the said that it was only a 1 in 4 chance of increasing your clank. Eek. So I've got a feeling that the signs were left by Tango, and whoever altered the game has done so without altering the signs, which gives us an insight as to what was done. So whether these are the actual chances in Tango's game or not, I don't know. And that indeed goes for the whole mechanisms, all the mechanisms down here that we're going to take a look at. They're not necessarily Tango's, they may have been altered. Well, some of them were altered as a necessity of making the game automatic to the degree where it could be played in single player. And an awful lot of work has gone into all this. So, yeah. Why does that go? That's the trigger for the cart, for the minecart. So whenever you actually trigger the end of game, the minecart goes around. Now, what happens? you put your shulker in here loaded with your cards, and it's then pumped into here. This hopper then takes the cards out of the box, and then we have a look at the back. This is the hopper that takes the cards out of the box, and they follow through here, and they're stolen by this hopper here, and they go into this dropper, which then drops them down. When you actually finish and you want the box, the shulker itself with your loaded cards, the hopper here is held off, and the shulker box gets biffed into this one and then goes through to here. So it's not stolen by this hopper, it goes through to this one here, which then takes it out. It then throws it to the front. So it's all a matter of timing. And it's pretty impressive, to be honest. When things go into the bottom dropper, it's detected, and then every time it's pulsed on and off. And this is an interesting one, because as long as there is something in there, and I'm going to have to use this circuit myself because I've just realized, power coming from the side then knocks this off. So this is a timed timed shifter, if you like. So each one is pulsed down here. Now the hoppers to take them are off to one side, and in order to get them in the right place, when they hit the chest is just set back a little, so the books don't go down in the center, they go down to the edge, and that's what enables them to be picked up by these hoppers, which are in a standard, you know, the usual configuration of being held off, which I think pretty much everybody's familiar with. And it's interesting how it's done, because let's just take a look at this one. This is resistance 3, resistance 2, resistance 1. Note the order of the books. So they come in and they go through these hoppers. So as resistance 3 drops in, it'll trigger a pulse there, it'll trigger a pulse there, and it'll trigger a pulse there as well. And when each one happens, it'll also trigger this, because they go into eventually this dropper, and the dropper is then told to trigger, and anything it's got goes down into water. So they pulse like this, and then the book comes down into water and goes on its merry way into the system, back up a water thing, and then water elevator, and then across here and into the chest here, which then goes into back into this chest here. So it takes some time for all this to happen. It gives a note when it does it, and because this is triggering here, like book 3 triggers 3 times, book 2 will trigger twice, book 1 will trigger once, and it's cumulative. So in that way, the system is cumulative. You'll get Beast Sense 2 either by a Beast Sense 2 card or 2 Beast Sense 1 cards. So the whole thing is cumulative in that regard. Now, anything else to say on this? I put that in as a catch-all because I was having problems with the system, and specifically some of the timings and various bits and pieces. On the whole, it works fine, it works flawlessly, except under a circumstance where I was seeing people play and they were keeping all their cards in the one shulker and moving, because the theory is that what some people were saying was that it will only take the cards out of the first floor 4 slots, and it's cumulative, so if you have a stack of a few in the first 4, they will all go. Not quite. There is a time. When you hit this button, there is a time circuit down here. That time circuit releases this redstone here, which allows the cards to be stolen out of the box for a certain period of time. So it will take the first X number of cards. If you've got too many cards in your pack, in your deck, it will jam the system. And I'll show you the jam happening. Now that's 9. This one will do it. There's 15 cards in here. And I'm going to load it and send it in. Notice that goes off. And it comes back on again. It's come on. You can't actually see what's in there. It's come on, and there's a card jammed here, and there are two more jammed there. You can hear the cards going through. And then they go through, and they go all the way up to the top again, and all the rest of that good jazz. So there we have a problem, because once you're through and finished, let's just toss that away. I can't actually see what's in there, so I can't see when it's finished, so I've just got to have a look, and I don't think there are any more books coming. You just hit the button and you get a book back. Oh dear, there go the other books. And there is our chest, which is short of a few books. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, it's short of a few books. And we'll probably find that they are now in here. There they are. So there are our books. So, you have to be careful how much you have in your deck when you put it in. I think that the best is 9. So we have 9 books here. I'm going to take that, stick it in. There it goes. Boom. The 9 have gone through the system. You may be able to push it to 10, possibly. But be careful of how many you have in your stack. And you can see the books coming through and going their merry way. It's absolute bloody genius. When you think that this was done 4 years ago, when we don't have some of the extra bits and pieces that we have now, he has probably superseded this many times over. So, there we have the system, and I think they're all back now. So we should be able to itemize the chest, take a look in it. There's our 9 books. Bingo. So, me being me, I wanted to see what I could do to make improvements on it. This is just for my experimentation. Tango has probably gone improved this numerous times since, because he made this 4 years ago. I'm just coming to this fresh, and I have a few things that are available to us in the game now that weren't available when Tango did it. So the first thing that I wanted to do was hopefully streamline some of the water stream to make it a bit faster. And what I did was I put a water stream underneath with ice as usual, and this goes straight in. So rather than going down and out, this goes down and through. Also, as part of the safety, anything that doesn't get chomped by here gets dropped off in the end into the stream, and it goes straight in that way and up and through. So that's pretty much how I did that. The first thing that I wanted to do was to make this a bit more efficient. And one of the key things that you've got to do with this is when you have a new source block, make sure you have it on its own block. Don't have it over a hopper. if you have it over a hopper, there is a chance that a book could come in, or an item could come in and get pushed down into the hopper when the hopper's not going to collect it anyway, and get stuck. So always have your fresh water blocks on its own block, not on a hopper. Otherwise, you could hit that problem. And that's how a lot of this was done and sped up that way. It turned a time of 9. The 9 took about 42 seconds on this one, and on this one it took 24. So that's nearly double the speed. Does that matter? In the context of the game, probably not. But in terms of hitting the button, turning around and going through the doors, that's probably taken you about 10 to 15 seconds already. So you've only got another, you know, 30 seconds before the game is fully programmed with whatever you've put in, assuming you've put in 9 cards. If you've only put in 1 or 2 cards, it's going to be a damn sight quicker. So, that was number one. Number two was that I wanted to get over that issue of having a large deck of cards and having it jam up like that. So I designed something. And me being me, I went a bit overboard. I tend to go for trying to make sure that things don't go wrong, rather than allowing things to happen, because you can actually press those buttons as you wish, however the system is. And there's also a possibility that I'm not sure if I just click this and get this away, you'll see that that triggers the cart, which actually has it actually triggered a book. Anyway, you actually have a loot finder one in here. There's no, oh, there's some in there. Are there any? Let's just get rid of those. That'll get rid of that. No, it hasn't got rid of that one. What's going on here? Oh, because there's nothing in the third one in order to trip it off. So I can just do that. Is there anything in here? Is there anything in the hopper? No, so next time I push it, I shouldn't get anything. No, I haven't. Good. It must have been, there must have been some books left over in the system from when I was testing things and learning how they worked. So, yeah. So I developed this. Yeah. Me being me, I went a bit overboard. So you get your shotgun deck of cards. In this case, we've got another 15. And I'm just going to copy that in here. And you put it against you. I've covered a lot of this stuff. You'll see that that would actually be polished. The only thing you can see is the dispenser down here. You can't see anything else. So you put it in here and you hit the button. What happens when you hit the button is that this comes out from here and pulses. The pulse is to the side and it pulses here. This does a number of things, one of which is this purple circuit releases this hopper. This hopper is actually holding a block behind this one. It's holding that block there. So when that block goes up, it reveals a hopper. So once that's revealed, what then happens is the signal goes down and it triggers this. This triggers the dispenser, because by now, it triggers this piston. This piston puts another block forward, which itemizes the shulker box. That then goes into the hopper and down into the dropper, which is beneath. Another signal here goes through here, which tells it to push out. But there's a timer signal here. When the timer signal starts, this piston comes back. That allows the dropper to actually put the shulker box here. So while the shulker box is there, the books are being drained down. And they are being drained down as long as this timer is running. When this timer stops running, the piston pushes the shulker box into here. That then goes into a dropper sequence here, which then, as there's something in it, when there's something in it, it pulses both both this one and the one above it. It pulses them both. Add a bit of a time delay to make sure that it chunks one upwards to this one, then it fires this one, which releases the shulker box. Fairly simple, straightforward mechanism. When you push the other button, that then any cards which are in play come back in to that box while it is in that position. You'll also notice another block here. When the system is in running mode, which is noted by this, this piston comes up. That brings the block up with it, which frees up the block which is above the shulker. That means that while the shulker is sat in this position, you can open it. The only thing that that you've got visible is the hopper feeding in. Well, there wasn't much I could do to hide that, and also the dispenser here. Not much I could do to hide that. So I've done what I can to hide things. So this is going to happen in relatively quick order. So here you go. Oof. That itemizes and goes down. The ticker kicks it. Then it goes down, through, and comes up. And we can open it. Notice that some books have gone down here. Relatively straightforward mechanism. It allows us to be able to capture books without the risk of messing around with the shulker box itself. So books are free to go through the system and come back into the hopper and come back into the shulker box while it's sat there. While you then press this button, it has a double piston assembly to actually make sure that the shulker box is itemized and pushed in your direction. There is a timing delay. In fact, I think I made it a bit longer on the others. And that is to make sure that this block is back in position first before these horizontal blocks itemize the shulker and push it towards you. The reason that that is done is to make sure that the shulker can't accidentally get trapped up here. So it makes damn sure that the shulker is itemized and out with you. So you can operate on the shulker while ever it's in there, and whenever you're ready to go, boom, hit the button and it's itemized, ready for you to pick up after you've messed around with your deck. So in both these positions, you can access the shulker box to do what you need to do with your deck of cards. What happened? Was there another shulker box waiting in there? Must have been. Or was it? I don't know. Let's try that again. Yeah. This is the problem with testing systems. You're leaving bits and pieces all over the place. That looks like that works. So, relatively simple mechanism that also makes use of the ability to hide the hopper when it's not in use. Also to make damn sure that the shulker box comes out towards you in good time. and that it doesn't end up hanging around inside or jammed up in that hole. So it's a relatively simple, straightforward mechanic. The only thing left to do then was marry the two together. And while I was doing this, Brian J was also doing some work on this, which is more dispensers filled with charge. But watch this. Watch my Y coordinate, which is in the bottom, which is currently in the bottom top left, currently in 5.0000. Once you've got a look at that, I'll step onto this. That was about 125, I reckon. I understand because there's more wind charges under here. And it is, if I get down in there, there is, oh, just brick. It was actually a functional block. Tools and utilities. No, functional block. Yeah, functional block. It was a decorated pot. Whoops. Decorated pot. Topped with a stone pressure plate. And you have to crouch down to place it. And I'm not going to retrieve that because I'll go for another flight. So, here we are. The whole thing is merged. Those lights don't fully work. And yeah, so I also decided then to add something in for the timing mechanism, because the timing mechanism here is done by a series of comparators, and two of these are in subtract mode, and by altering the pulse that is in from the left, I can thus alter the time. Brian suggested this, and I had to scratch my head as to how on earth I was going to make this work with the various other redstone that's needed to do various triggering, and it drove me insane for a while until eventually I cracked it. So these hold various amounts of redstone, which will generate various different signals. At the moment, there's nothing in there, which means that it will take 12 from a shulker box. So you can increase the hardness by determining how many items this will take. Let's just run a clear here, and we'll copy that. You can see that that's got 15 in it. So we'll put that in there. I'll run the system with a level 4 one item. So as you can see, that's now power 3 to there and 2 to there. Boom. Oh, it's taken 2. I gotta fine tune this. And then there they are. It's not 100% accurate. And there they go. And now they can kick it back out again. Where'd it go? Right, there was one already in there. That's what happens when you test the damn things. So that's roughly how this is happening. It's it should just take one item. Oh, of course, this is going to do that. Yep. Oh no, 2 books. Basically, what I've done is I've been altering these as I've made changes elsewhere on the other systems. I've come back and retrofitted them, which means some of them are slightly out of whack now. But that's how that was working. However, I was having issues with the timing and with books getting stuck in these droppers. Not every time, but every now and then. Nothing in there at the minute, especially when I fire a lot of things at it. I also increased the timings because this is the timer that is responsible for kicking out the books, and I sped it up as fast as I could. And the test for this, let's just ditch some of that, is this one, stealth 3, 2 and 1. So we'll just copy that, and it's going to fire all these three books down at the stealth line simultaneously. Yeah. And through that, I think that was how I was getting some books stuck. No, not this time. Oh, it was this one, that's why. Was it this one? No. No, that's B-Sense. This was the stealth. So sometimes, not all the time, it'll mess up. Oh, damn. That's because it needed to, that needs to be reset. So that does that. Right. So here we go. Three. Now it'll go in. We can open it. And we'll just wait for them to come in. Now, that is a bit of an annoyance that I also solved. Which is the status of the block, which allows you to, you've got to officially use it the correct way in order for the correct blocks to fire. Otherwise, the shulker box goes in and you can't open it. So that resulted in yet another one. What did I do to this? Oh yeah, this one was converted the drop trigger to observers. Now it relies on every time that this triggers on these firing. So the idea is that whenever the last one fires, anything which is in here will get done. And if it's a higher book, as it works its way through, any books that are stuck will get ejected as well. Now, because I increased the timing or made it a bit tighter, I was ending up with books getting stuck. So what I did was I swapped out the mechanism with observers. So as long as there is a book in here, it will bring this piston to bring this observer close to that one, which will keep firing the dropper until it's empty. Now, I have actually had that jam on me. I don't like using this. It's just a way of potentially looking at solving a problem. But I have had the observer pistons jam on me. Yeah, c'est la vie. So, hey-ho. So that was the way of solving that one. Then I went a bit further. What did I do with this one? Took collection system to hoppers. Yes. I decided to do away with the whole collection thing and put hoppers in instead. So the hoppers now go to a dispenser stroke dropper, which pumps them into this line, which then goes up. And it has, again, it has this on it, but hey-ho. Have I still got that on it? Yeah, I'll have to replace that. So yeah, rather than have the water system, it goes down through hoppers instead. There is a time penalty, but not quite what you'd think. Note with a single card, it took up to 16 seconds on the water-based. 12 card, 32 seconds. With this one, while the single card went up to 20 seconds, about a 4-second delay, the other one only went up to 33 seconds. So the more cards you've got through it, going through, the time differential is minimal. Absolutely nothing at all. So, yeah. So that roughly does that. We're at 20. Let's just run a clear and grab this one, which has 15. Are we in locked off? Yes, we're in the correct order. Boom. There goes that one. And 33 is still shorter. There they go through. And here they start coming back in again. Come on, you can do it. There you go. And there's our ejected box. So yeah, it does take a little bit longer, but in the great scheme of things, not too bad at all. And I finally ended up with this one, where I introduced a locking mechanism at the top. So if you're running, you can't press one button without the other button having been pressed first. So this this determines whether the system is running or not, and what state it's in, as to which button will pass through. And this one actually is coloured. Oh, that is the delay I put in. Okay, fair enough. So you can just, you can't press one. Like, I can press this one as much as I like, nothing's going to happen until I've pressed this one. Off it goes. Note that that is now open up there. You can hear it all firing away. Boom, boom. All of our books. And our itemized chest. Ta-da! Everything's clear. Yeah. So that's roughly how this has been going on. Have I tuned this one yet? I don't know. Level 5 should be no items, so it should go from one to the other with no items taken. In theory. No, something got taken. Level 5, that's 6. I need that to be 7. But there were a few oddities with the bits and pieces. Is this one? There is another one which I have tuned. So that's just a matter of how much redstone signal is coming in here and what happens. And yeah, so if I introduce that to 7, which is... is that 7 now? That's 8, too much. Yeah, that's 7. Ah, this one hasn't been altered. Ha! Right, yep, the timings have got to be altered on that one. So roughly, that's how it goes, and you just got to press that to reset. So yeah, so that's roughly how it's going on. It's just a case of the timings for the various bits and pieces that are going off. Yeah, I think I've got one in the museum that I've altered the timing on. If not, I'll just have to have a look at it. So this is a copy of that one. I'll have to copy out again, thinking of where things are. But yeah. Because it is tight timing. You need it to launch the shulker, then knock it off before the hopper gets a chance to take anything out of it. So it is a very tight timing indeed. Very tight. These are the blocks. Boom. Barrier. That's the puppies. Can you actually see barrier? No, you can't see it. You're going to have to use an admin command to get to that one. But the barrier block... If you're holding it, it'll show you the barrier blocks. If you're not, they all appear invisible. But the barrier block is what's principally stopping the ravagers in the maze from committing harikiri in the lava. Yeah, it's very tight timing to get it. For a shulker box to go in and to knock off again without anything being taken out of it. Very tight. And I think this is the one that I've been working on. You can see that castle, incredible, isn't it? Brian was saying it's mostly made out of wood, believe it or not. Right. Oh, level 5, one item. Oh, I haven't, may not have altered the signs, possibly. No. Yes, I haven't altered the sign. That one is done. Level 5, no items. Does that... will it happen again? Yep, it's happened again. Consistency. So there you have some sort of basic difficulty system as to how many cards it will take out of your deck. But they are cumulative, so yeah, two beast sense one or whatever it is will ping twice, and a beast sense two will also ping twice, and it relies on whatever mechanism is on the other end of these lines to interpret the pings and do whatever they're going to do with them. So that is going to be some of the next bits and pieces that have to be done. Obviously you could tidy this up with a selector and then just alter, you know, I could have a row going this way of hoppers and just feeding down the line into here to alter the strength and do it that way, you know, and then have some fancy buttons on the wall that have the selection mechanism behind it in order to trigger or not trigger any of the pistons. And relatively straightforward, really. So yeah, this is just proof of concept. I love this. I think it is... I would never have thought of this mechanism and doing things this way. Hats off to Tango. He's just incredible with the redstone. And, yeah, what do you say? It's impressive. It is just so impressive. And there go the books. There is a counting system here, which was which consists of two hoppers. In theory, it throws a log up. Whenever it drops one down, it throws a log up. And whenever it sees something coming through one of the hoppers, it drops another log down. However, it doesn't work properly because some of the books come through way too fast. So I'm going to need another counting mechanism. It's just a way to determine whether or not it's safe to actually take out the shulker box. So it is. It would be, if it was reliable, it would be possible to put a lock on, so that if the system is running, you can't eject the shulker box until all your cards are back, and that should be possible. However, what may be possible is to have them go into. Something like a dropper or something, and then use something like the system. Where have I got it? I got a number of systems here. That isn't it. This is the... no, it isn't. That's not it either. In fact, did I put a sign here? Yes, I did. Ensures an even split, no matter what their timing. This is the one, the hopper stream splitter divider. Ah, no, it isn't. It's the other one. There is another one. Where is it? Where are you? There's too many things in this sodden museum. It's not that one. That's the lock-off mechanism. There should be another one. Hopper stream splitter divider. You know, it is this one. This one, no matter what their timing. So as things come in, they are held in order to go off in a pulsed way. So then something like the comparator would pick up an accurate number of books that are coming in. How to work that in easily? I don't think I can. Yeah, that's a puzzler. I'll have to work on that one. But once I've cracked that, it would be possible to put a lock on here so you can't actually hit the button until all the books are safely back in your shulker. Yeah. That would be a good thing, I think. Worth working on. So there you go. Another look at Tango's genius and how I've yet to take more of Decked Out to pieces to see how it works. But a lot of the stuff is running on chance, and it's running on dropper chance, which itself isn't a new mechanic. None of these seem to be new mechanics, it's just the way that they're put together. And bloody hellfire, the sodding barriers. It's the way that Tango's put them together is just inspirational, pretty much. It's, and how he's there's a load of redstone above all of this as well, which is also fed into the various mechanics that are going on below, in order to open or close the various doors that are going off. Like this is these are the piston doors. As you can see, you can now see through, so a beast could see you. And if there was a lever here, if there was a redstone signal from the top, all of that would be closed off. Pretty impressive. So again, some of the mechanisms that I've seen above here appear to imply that chance is also a factor in whether any of these are open or closed. And that chance itself seems to depend on other chances. And you've really got to keep your eyes open for other barrels with bits and pieces all over the place. And there's one, there was one right, there's one there with a load of goodies in it. And there's another one up there. How the heck do you get up there? That's going to take some hopping, skipping and jumping to get to, I'm telling you. Yeah. And you've got to do all this against the clock, because yeah, it's very impressive. Is the mechanism running? No, it isn't. It's all cut out from underneath on this one. But the whole point of this was to get a look at the map and get used to it and know which area you're in and what danger you're actually facing. Because in the last one, the target key that I needed was there. The drop-off point was actually in this room for my compass 10, because my compasses are, I had to realign them all, so my compass 10 ends up in there. But there was a Ravager in there, there was another one that was already in this area, and I was in this area, so how the hell was I going to get there? As it turns out, there's a secret entrance. It's not working here, but that will take you down through an underground passage and will actually lead you out here. Pretty impressive. So you can do things like that. Some of these secrets are not only secrets, they're necessary to know, otherwise you stand very little hope of surviving in this damn dungeon. It's genius. It's absolute genius. The amount of thought that must have gone into this, and the creative form of making these dungeon areas and making everything look so good and function so well is just whoa. And he did it all on Hermitcraft. I mean, good grief, it's stunning. My flabber is well and truly ghasted, or my ghast is well and truly flabbered, whatever they say. You know, all the details that are going into making bits and pieces and making this look so good, it's just yeah. Some of these aren't functional, so you think, oh god, that's going to go up, but there wasn't any redstone behind it, nor with that one either, which is just as well. Yeah, so it's really stunning to see this put together, and to see particularly those blocks to make them look like they're bunk beds. It's just wow. Mind blown. And he did all this 4 years ago when Minecraft was older and not so many features around. Absolutely incredible. Unfortunately, because this is being plugged into Creative, some of the things like the smithy has gone, some of the other bits and pieces have also gone as well, like the fire spark and a few other bits and pieces, but hey ho, you live with it. The redstone functions, which is what the main thing is all about. Yeah, so I don't know what I'm going to take apart next. I still got a little bit of work to do on these. I've got to do the timing mechanism to throw up and get rid of some of the other bits and pieces. And it's interesting. How did you do the timer? Is that followed by that and that? So it's that. It's over there. That's why. I'm going to have to do a bit of thinking about that one. But I'll get it done. Yeah. Thoroughly impressed. Very thoroughly impressed. It's very impressive what he's done. And how it all hangs together and works. And very inspiring to learn from all this. Because it's only by... a lot of the trick with redstone is inspiration. And getting that inspiration to do various bits and pieces. And work on mechanisms. And to inspire you to make your own mechanisms. Which is basically what's happened here. Once you add in all this, I think my mechanism is actually a bit bigger than his. Incredible. What do you say? It's just inspiring. So, decked out too. I'm not sure what's going to happen with that. It's going to take me ages to get hold of, to come to terms with everything that's in here so far, to be perfectly honest with you. It's just impressive. The soul flames appear to be lit at the start of every game, and again it's another admin thing, whereas he must have done his calculations as to how many times people are going to play. This is actually the cutout section that I'm approaching now, and I don't want to hang on too much longer. But where am I? That's the entrance, which means the one I want is where? Up here, possibly. They're all over the place. Through. Where are the soul flames? Oh, this is actually running. There's one. The soul flames are obviously taking place on soul soil, and they're lit by dispensers of fire charge. There's a lot of fire charge in there. There's about 100, 200, 300, 400, about 500 fire charge in there, so that should last plenty of games before he's got to come in and maintain these. And how he remembers all this is just astounding. Well, he did build a whole thing. Is that another one? Yeah, that's another one. And all this behind the scenes. So it looks like at the start of every game, a fire charge is fired. If it has been put out. So I think if you put the fire charge out, the observer picks up the fact that a fire charge has gone out and triggers a couple of droppers. I'm not totally sure how this is working and what happens. This must happen. What a new game is started. What the heck is that dropper for the chance of? That red, something else. That's going down there. For a chance. If this is what I think it is, when the game starts, it effectively throws the dice, and the dice determine whether, and you've got a one in six chance here of the piston for this soul flame being open. So much of this is on chance. It is pretty impressive. Yeah, so when the game starts, the dice is thrown and you stand a chance of a soul flame being open for dousing. And it wouldn't surprise me if the chances are different for different soul flames. But one of the other things that I have seen is that the chances have been changed by whoever it is that worked on it to take it into single player. The whole thing is impressive, thoroughly impressive. I mean, good grief. Yeah, I'm in awe at this. It's just incredible. I dread to think the complexities that he's built into, decked out to. That must be phenomenal. But I think he's running more on other mods and things. He's moved on from using Redstone in innovative ways, and I think he must have moved on to various mods. It's just incredible. All you do is just awe-inspiring, the stuff that's been done. Yeah. So, I hope you've liked this look into the decked-out card selection mechanism, and I'll catch you on the next one. Till then, ciao for now.